I'm going to present a very new work today, and I request this audience to be patient and understanding that this is work in progress. I welcome suggestions, criticisms, and opinions from the audience. Since we are really short of time and I have been asked to keep it short, I'm not going to read this entire paper. I will read only small parts of it. So I will summarize as I'm going on. What I'm trying to do here is to present a particular moment in the history of modern Mysore, and particularly the history of the Mysore Matha, which is, as you know, an institution which has a long history in the region of Karnataka. Let me start by remembering M.M. Kalburgi, who in his introduction to a book on Lingayat Mathas in Karnataka by Chandrasekhar Naranapura, said that the function of the Veerashaiva Matha in many parts of Karnataka as an unofficial government, anadhikrata sarkara, while making the distinction, and he was making a foundational distinction between the Dharmamukhi Matha and the Samajamukhi Matha. In doing this, he also listed the social services that were rendered by the contemporary Matha, serving food, providing education, ensuring health, meeting out justice, or promoting literature, while simultaneously tending to the spiritual needs of its adherents. But Kalburgi then goes on also to signal the very new kinds of activities in which Mathas engage in contemporary Karnataka, from running commercial establishments to even running cinema theaters. So no doubt there is a project here to understand how the Matha has been shaped, particularly by the arrival of representational politics in the period after independence. My own interest today and in this paper is to present a prior moment, which I am describing as the moment when the Matha is being made into a modern institution. And that moment, which I'm referring to, is the late 19th century and the earlier 20th century in Mysore. I'm really fortunate to have here in the audience Aya Ikagame, who has already looked at the Matha, and she, as well as Aditya Sood, have suggested very strongly that we must see a certain kind of shared sovereignty operating between state and Matha. My own position is going to differ slightly from this, because the argument that I'm going to make is that we must take, and I think here I'm echoing also what David Washbrook said in his keynote address, we must understand that colonial power was dramatically and substantially different from any previous kind of power, especially in the transformations that it brought about in this institutional space of the Matha. So I am not putting too much stress on the idea of continuity, but rather I am suggesting that the instruments and modalities of colonial modernity under a rapidly bureaucratizing state brought new visibility and public accountability to the Matha. In the period from the mid-19th century, I am suggesting a triangulated space of publicness emerged between the bureaucratic Mysore state, between its governmentalized people, and the third part of that triangle, of course, being the modernized Matha itself. Now, this space was co-constituted by the state's regularization and hierarchization of Mathas according to age and wealth, the development of a new and more socially purposive meaning for the public life of the Matha, both and new ways of collective belonging among adherents, symbolized by a public, both drawing on and at a remove from caste identity. So the caste identity is not something from which the caste group can distance itself, and yet there is a very interesting kind of compromise made between caste identity and the new kind of associational forms that are emerging at this period. I am again stressing that the Mysore Matha and its new institutional practices marked a sharp disjuncture from its historically produced forms. And here I want to say one more thing, which is that the presence of the Maharaja of Mysore in these debates, discussions, and decisions is strictly spectral. It is not, in that sense, a formative presence. It's not a formative kind of force. It's a very spectral presence, which I would say actually affirms the fact that the Mysore Matha has traveled a great deal from the kind of symbiotic relationship to kinship to trace a completely new trajectory of publicness. I'm giving it that name. It's not a very nice word, but I'm using it for want of anything better. There is a new kind of publicness that is emerging at the intersection of the state's interests and the caste community's identity. It'll interest you to know that the bureaucratization of the Matha actually has its roots in the period of Tipu Sultan, who at least some scholars have begun to recognize as an emblem of early Indian modernism. We do not see him as somebody who is representing some kind of medieval monarchical state, but rather as someone who was committed to promoting a kind of indigenous modernism. I'm saying this because vis-a-vis Mathas, he issued a circular in 1790-91, in which he laid down very important and very bureaucratized procedures by which temples, chhatrams, mathas, mosques, and masjids and dargahs would come under the scrutiny of the government, be made accountable, as it were, for the kinds of grants, whether it was made as land or in ready money by the government. Now, this was the inaugural moment in bureaucratizing the Matha, and that is of some interest here today, because when the British take over in 1799 and they put Diwan Purnaya in charge of the new Mysore state, he too is carrying on in some ways Tipu's approach to the Mathas in terms of confining their importance and confining the amount that is actually bestowed on these institutions. Under the direct rule of the Maharaja from 1811, you see a massive swelling in the support of these institutions, which made the British extremely alarmed and, of course, led them to institute a new kind of limit to which you could actually bestow grants on Mathas and temples. Now, the difficulty that the Matha and the temple posed to British rule, as was true of many parts of India, was that interference in the economic and cultural resources of religious institutions could lead to conflicts over legitimacy and authority between elites and with the British. Nevertheless, I'm arguing that the colonial authorities, despite their avowals to the contrary, penetrated, reorganized, and secularized the meaning and content of temple rituals, revenues, and finances of Mathas and temples, and reinscribed their status within colonial society. This was done in a variety of ways, but the effort was to manage religious institutions, a compromise that was arrived at by Bowring when he took over the commissionership of Mysore, was to have Indian officers staffing these departments of the government to control misappropriation of revenue, to institute a regular audit of the accounts of each institution, compared to the tasdeeq patties, which were the lists of sanctioned amounts of expenditures. All of this was state intervention on a very large scale, because the state was also trying to reserve the right to replace managements that were inefficient, resume lands when more efficient managements could not be found. Now, in 1883, in the Mysore Representative Assembly, there are persistent demands for the establishment of a separate, for a set of reforms in temple and matha management. The Mysore government gives in and appoints a special officer as a Muzrai superintendent. And this new officer, A. Srinivasacharalu, briskly went about this business of introducing new budgets and sanctions, appointing dharmadarshis, revising the tasdeeq patties, all of which were aimed at restoring the original objects of grants made to temples, securing better officials for temples, and so on and so forth. In short, the Muzrai superintendent was intended to impart to the worship and rituals therein more impressiveness and solemnity by stricter conformity with the spirit of the Hindu religion as expounded by accepted authorities. And, you know, many scholars, including D.E. Smith, have noted that there was an extraordinary detail with which the bureaucracy went into the functionings of these institutions. And that is actually quite remarkable, because that kind of detailed scrutiny did not happen in many other locations. I have looked at some detail the abolition of Devdasi dance, as was occasioned actually by the Muzrai department in a paper which is part of my book. So I'm not going to go into that there, but that was one of the successful reforms which were undertaken by the Muzrai department. So I'm suggesting that there is a new visibilization of the affairs of the Matha to the state, and this was crucially aided by the emergence of a new and more assertive public, which demanded a different kind of accountability from the Matha and asserted a great degree of interest in controlling it. These forms of assertion may be sharply distinguished from the relation between Matha and earlier forms, community forms of adherence, or nadadu kolluvaru. The new community and its demands, therefore, co-constituted, along with the state, the publicness of the Mysore Matha. And it is to some of these features. So I'm going to outline, because of very little time, just outline to you some of the features of this publicness as they emerge in what I think is actually a very crucial period for the emergence of the modern Mysore Matha. Prithvi Chandra Shobhi, who's here also with us, in his analysis of the demand for a past amongst the members of the modern Lingayat caste, argues that the history of Lingayat Mathas from the 15th century became a rich resource for defining a new caste identity and in building and sustaining a consensus within the community on doctrinal matters. So one of the things I'm suggesting is happening in this period is that there is a recognition that in order to establish your mamul, that is custom, or haq, that is right, or any kind of privilege or right, you have to deploy the resources of history. You have to establish the antiquity of your matha. And this is something which comes to the fore in many of the debates and discussions that are happening here. I will just take up one case to illustrate the kinds of tensions into which mathas were drawn. This is a series of claims which emerged in Sirigere, a village in Chitradurga district. And in this three and sometimes four-cornered contests, the relative age, or more correctly, the relative newness of each matha came repeatedly into question. On the one hand was the struggle between two relatively new mathas based in Sirigere itself, the old Sirigere matha and the new Sirigere matha, which laid claim to a subsect of the Lingayats, the Sadars and the Nonabars. On the other was the well-established Chitradurga and Balehalli matas, which strained to prevent the schism within Lingayat ranks. On 29th September 1905, the district magistrate of Chitradurga granted the new Sirigere Matha a license to use four forms of honor in public processions. Mena, Kempuchatri, Kahale, Samela, Baju Bhajantri. I'm sure you all know this. The Matha made an appeal to the deputy commissioner of the district for all eight honors. So let me not read that list out, but in that year itself, you have a challenge from the old Sirigere Matha saying that the new Sirigere Matha was not entitled to these honors, and a revised order was passed favoring the old Sirigere Matha in October 1905. And in February 1906, the new Sirigere Matha again takes the dispute, this time to the Mysore Chief Court, which saw no reason to interfere. Not to be defeated, the new Sirigere Matha then goes straight to the government. Now, one of the arguments made by the old Sirigere Matha is that the new Sirigere Matha is an upstart. It is a very new Matha, and that therefore the real, true, original Matha is the old Sirigere Matha. And the interesting thing is that the old Sirigere Matha itself was facing a challenge from the Murugi Matha in Chitradurga and the Balehalli Matha, which said in turn that the old Sirigere Matha was a result of somebody who was disgruntled and who had been outcast, or rather excommunicated, and set up the new Matha on his own. Now, in all this, the Mathas are pressed to establish their antiquity. And the old Sirigere Matha does this in very interesting ways. It does this by suggesting that their roots are actually at least 100 years old. Their roots are actually in the late 18th century, with the migration of Jambappa Wadayar to Sirigere. And what is the proof that they provide for this? They provide the proof of the gaddiges, that is to say, the graves of the saints, of which they say three at least are in Sirigere, and those, by the way, exist up to the present day. Now, this claim to antiquity becomes a very important part of this jockeying for power within a new emerging hierarchy of Mathas. I'm not going to have time, unfortunately, to tell you the outcome of all these struggles, but perhaps this can come up later in our discussions. I'm just citing this as one of the registers on which this modernity was staged, that you had to establish your antiquity. But that was not enough, and so I move to the next point that I want to make about the emergence of what we might call the document Raj and its procedures. Now, the document Raj, as we sometimes refer to colonial power as, was not something which was content with merely a claim to antiquity. It had to be proved, if possible, through the production of certain kinds of documents. And here, the Chitradurga Matha and the Balehalli Matha had the upper hand, because they were able to produce, to prove their antiquity, three things. One, an 1812 Nirup, which was provided by Krishnaja Wadayar in February 1812, which actually was a kind of a negative Nirup, because it said that the Nonabars and the Sadars will not be permitted to have their own leader or head. The second was a Shah Amil order, again under the regime of Krishnaja Wadayar in 1825, which again says that these subgroups of the Lingayats should not ask for a separate Matha of their own. And finally, they also had an 1838 Rahadari, which is a document which exempts travelers from paying tolls in the case of the use of certain kinds of vehicles and so on, which was issued by the Nagar superintendent in favor of the Bali, not a Nirup from the Maharaja, please note. This is a Rahadari which is issued by the Nagar superintendent, who is an official of the colonial state, in favor of the Balehalli Matha, spelling out that Sadars and Nonabars need not have a new ayah against mamul, so against the custom, in short. So the question that is coming up here is, what is the original source of authority? Is it the monarch, or is it the newly formed and newly appearing bureaucrat? or is it the newly instituted system of justice, namely the court? It's a very important question that emerges in these debates and struggles around antiquity, because what the older Mathas are arguing is that the original authority can only originate with the monarch, that is to say, with the king. There, nothing else can take its place. Certainly, the generative power that the license appears to be part of, that is, the license is not merely something that is granted by a bureaucrat for some one function, but it appears to be something which is generating a new kind of haq. That is something which should definitely not be allowed. The license cannot be confused with or mistaken for the royal sanad or the royal nirup. Because, as they claim, and I'll just quote, the fountainhead of spiritual authority, the Murugu Rajendra Matha, is going to be disturbed if the license of the colonial bureaucrat is going to be equated to the nirup of the king. So that's the second point that I want to make. The third point I want to make is that what is being inaugurated in this period are what I call the arts of being seen and being heard in the public spaces. Again, for want of time, let me not go into the details here, except to say, give you one example. One example which is referring again to the period of the Maharaja of Mysore issuing an order in 1816 entitling the Sri Murugu Rajendra Matha of Chitradurga to, and I quote, all the usual privileges as those exercised by Sringeri Swamigalu. So what is happening here is, in the task of hierarchizing the Mathas, there is a new kind of symmetry that is being sought, a new kind of symmetry between Mathas of the Lingayats with the supreme, or the most important Matha, which is, of course, Sringeri. The Mysore Maharaja is actually conceding this right in an order. And you see the effects of this in a very different way almost a century later, in 1908, when the Brahmins of Doddaguni, Bagalkote, and Athene complained about the chanting of the Vedas in the public street and the Swami of Sirigire styling himself as a Jagadguru. That's the complaint, that he should not be doing this when we are Brahmins and they are only Lingayats. But the Muzrai department issues an order that upholds these activities. And the grounds on which they uphold this activity is what is of interest to me here today. And I quote, such chanting in the public streets violates no right of the Brahmin which can be upheld by a government or a court of law. There's something very decisive about that, that statement. There is nothing that the Brahmin can claim as a privilege on a public street which has been constructed by a government in power, and it certainly cannot be upheld in a court of law. And they see no objection to the Swami styling himself as Jagadguru and to his disciples praising him as such. Now this is why I say to you that we have to pay attention to the details, to the fine grain of the quality of the discussion that was happening at this moment, which is actually shifting power away from certain kinds of received or ascribed powers to a power that can be achieved. So I have another very interesting argument that happened about whether the use of chamara, which is listed by the colonial official, actually entitles the Matha, in this case the old Sirigire Matha, to use a pair of fly whisks. That is, can you use ubhaya chamara, that is two of them, or are you only entitled to use one? Was this a deliberate misreading of the grammatical lapse of a hapless official, or a deliberate failure to enumerate the list of sanctioned honors? So various kinds of such debates are going on. You might think they're very small, extremely symbolic, but they occupied, obviously, a great deal of time and attention. I'm going to skip the next section for want of time. It is basically making the argument that there was a third level at which this transformation of the Matha is happening, and that is the increasing interest that the state begins to show in the persona of the Mathadipati. The persona of the Mathadipati becomes very crucial to determine whether it is not just his physical and his mental health, as in the case of the Sringeri Swamiji in 1928, or it might also refer to the actual qualifications for being the head of a Matha. The knowledge of Sanskrit, as you know, was imperative, and not just any kind of knowledge of Sanskrit, but certified knowledge of Sanskrit, preferably through governmental institutions of Sanskrit. This was what the demand was by the state. So let me not go into the details of that, but that's what that section deals with. I'm coming now to the last section, and I'm going to take a little time to finish by reading this, because I'm making the argument on that what is also happening in the other arm, as it were, of this triangle is the formation of a new public, and for which caste is becoming capital. That is to say, caste is itself a form of capital that is being used in the formation of a new public. Unlike Kerala, for which Uday Kumar has demonstrated that there was a very sort of interesting idea of the people or the public emerging out of anti-caste movements, we did not have in Mysore a similar kind of single anti-caste movement. Rather, you have the formation of certain kinds of samajas or sanghas as they moved away from the idea of the Nadedu Kolluva Jana, from that embeddedness and subordination to the Matha order, but not fully relinquishing that link. So you're not relinquishing your link with the Matha, rather you are recasting it in order to actually control the Matha. The battles between the Murgi and the Balehali Mats on the one hand, and the old Sirigire Matha and the new Sirigire Matha on the other, were not merely to cohere and consolidate the lower rank sadars and nonabars within the larger Lingayat community, if necessary, by invoking broader geographical loyalties. Nor was it to mimic them, as the lower rank Lingayats pulling away from the Mula Matha quickly revealed. In rejecting the affiliation, but not the form, when they set up the alternatives, lower rank castes not only expressed their growing economic status, but also channelized their secular aspirations through the Matha. The moment simultaneously was one that individuated and affiliated, succeeded in publicly consolidating caste as a form of capital. Now, of what did this publicness consist? I am arguing here that it consists of three things. One is the stress and the importance that these middle castes are actually placing on the state to guarantee certain formal symmetries. And in that process, and this here I'm referring in particular to the demand for education that is happening amongst these middle class castes. I'm referring primarily to Wokligas and the Lingayats, who are, of course, putting pressure on the state to admit them to these institutions. But it is the Matha that provides that very crucial resource which will make possible an education in the governmental institutions, namely in the creation and maintenance of hostels. The hostel becomes one of the most important measures and institutional spaces that are generated by the Matha in the process of enabling these middle castes who are demanding an education to actually acquire an education. And you will see in the beginning of the 20th century that there is an extraordinary thirst for the setting up of hostels, particularly in the Lingayat Mathas. The second register on which this publicness is defined is vis-a-vis the community as a mobilizable entity. Now, there is a flurry of petitions which are being submitted to the government on the complaints that the public has against the Matha. It might be misappropriation, it might be the arguments that the people have about who should be the head of a particular Matha and who should succeed in the headship once the Mathadipati dies. It might be something to do with restoration of lands which have been resumed by the state for misappropriation. Whatever it is, we see an extraordinary burst of petitions. That is to say, people who are actually signing these documents in support of an argument that the state must intervene to recast or correct certain kinds of deficiencies within the matter. So you have a publicness that is visible in these documents, in these signatures as well. This is something that has been shown quite well for Bengal vis-a-vis the social reform movements. But for me, in Mysore, it seems to me, since it was a rather weak sort of, there were weak sort of social reform measures of the kind we've seen in other parts of India, this is the moment when the public is declaring itself so strongly in favor of government intervention. And the third and the last point that I want to make in this transformation of caste as a form of capital is in the marshalling, is in asserting a right to serve, or rather insisting that the Matha serve the emerging community and its secular demands in molding the Matha into an institution for enabling access to general education. Between the 1891 census, when castes were recorded in ranked hierarchies within Hinduism, and the 1901 census, which merely retained an alphabetical listing of Hindus, of which the Lingayats were just one caste, a dramatic shift had occurred in self-perceptions of Veerashaivas as Lingayats. With the establishment of the Mysore Lingayat Educational Fund Association in 1905, the All India Veerashaiva Mahasabha, and the Praja Mitra Mandali in 1917, the increased demand for education was recognized not just by the state, but by the Mathas themselves. The most dramatic shift away from dharmic education to the secular occurred in the Chittadurga Matha and the Suttur Matha in the early 20th century, followed by the Sirigire Matha in the middle of the century and the Siddhaganga Mathas. And this is history. We know how these Mathas have become at the forefront of not just providing basic secondary and primary education, but also in enhancing their role in technical, medical, and other kinds of education as well. As at first begun to provide facilities to their adherents who accessed education in government schools in towns and colleges through the construction of hostels, the Mathas moved into the establishment of educational institutions themselves. And these were educational institutions, let us remind ourselves, that increasingly took in people not only from the specific caste for which the Matha was actually, which the Matha was actually serving, but a more mixed caste kind of public. And this is actually the pioneering moment when the Matha is describing itself as a charitable institution. This is what is recognized actually by among others, Mirza, when he says that this is going well beyond our conventional understandings of charitable institutions, because they are serving not only their own adherents, but serving members of various other communities as well. So I'll just point out that when the Suttur Matha, Jangam Matha, which numbered its disciples at 4,000, made a case for honors as late as 1937, which were not due to the Jangam Matha, it cited its antiquity. I've mentioned this, that antiquity was a major kind of convincing ploy on the part of the Mathas themselves. But the Muzrai Commissioner finally grants these honors on three grounds. It says, and I quote, "The Matha is old, the Swami is learned, and the clinching question, he has endowed a large sum for a patashala." This becomes a reason for him to be awarded the honors on the streets of Suttur, which the Brahmins had long been opposing. The admiration of the government for the new role that would be played by the Matha as a partner in educating the population was quite different, I would say, from the reciprocity that might have existed between king and Matha. There had been a close link between Mathas and hostels from as early as the middle of the 19th century. I've already pointed to this. And as I said, this is becoming translated into a demand not merely for the hostel, but for Vidya Abhivradi itself, in order to then compete with a disproportionately large presence of Brahmins in public life. I'm going to conclude with just one note. Now, the archive that has enabled me to stand here before you and describe this very important moment in Mysore history is something that was generated by the modern Mysore state during the colonial period, and it has allowed for the kinds of rich reflections, unfortunately, for want of time, I could not give you more details, which are in the paper, on the publicness of the Matha. But this publicness has today disappeared. The compulsions of representational politics, so well described in a number of biographies and autobiographies, has resulted in the dismantling of the document Raj, at least as far as all the important Mysore or Karnataka Mathas is concerned. This new official invisibilizing of the Matha, even as it occupies the place of an anadhikrita sarkara, is indeed a paradox that needs urgent investigation. Thank you.